edit whenever I need to.
This meeting has now come to order. Now you're probably wondering why I brought you all here today. It's about conventions. It's got to stop. How are you, everybody? Everybody having a good day today? You having a good time this weekend?
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Got rid of the rain finally. A nice little bit of sunshine today. Not too hot, not too cold. Well, let me just say, my name's Garry Chuff. I'm a voice actor, camera, film actor, stage actor. I'm basically an actor. I've been an actor for over 40 years. And working in media for at least 35, 36 years. And run a whole gamut of different things. Everything from being dressing up in a gorilla and doing singing telegrams for birthdays and whatnot to a greeter at a convention and actor, you name it, I've done it all. So I don't really know what the focus of today's panel will be. What would you like to focus? Because I can speak on anything. What is something that's really intriguing for you? What would you like to know?
I guess most of the people here, or at least this guy beside me, he likes Beast Wars, so.
Beast Wars?
Maybe why don't you talk a little Transformers, maybe?
A little bit of Transformers? Well, I can talk Transformers for you. Transformers and I go back to, I guess my first exposure to the Transformers was I used to do the commercials for, the television commercials for Transformers Generation 2. And then I was the voiceover guy. I was Transformer Generation 2, battery sold separately. You know, I used to be that guy. I used to do cat toys and whatnot. And I started doing cartoons in about 1982, I think. My first cartoon was Hiawatha. And since then, I've come to do like several thousand cartoons and different characters. But one of the pivotal points in my life was being asked to audition for the part of Optimus Prime and Megatron in the new Beast Wars cartoon. Now, I know that Transformers had been around for quite a while, but then it disappeared. In 1982, we never really saw, or 1984, I think we never really saw the Transformers again. And then someone came up with this new idea of having them transform from animals into robots and robots into animals. And they came up with Beast Wars. And so I went and thought, well, this is kind of intriguing. I auditioned for it and auditioned for it and auditioned for it yet again and finally got the part. Well, to tell you the truth, I had no idea of what a deal that was. To me, it didn't seem like a big deal. And I've been doing a lot of cartoons since then and or before that, and so I just thought, oh great, another cartoon. And I started recording it with the cast of David Kay and Venus Turzo and Ian and Scotty and all those people, and started having a great time. And I never realized of what a big deal it was till I went to my very first convention, a BotCon convention in Anaheim in California. And I don't know, were you there? I don't think you were there. No, you were in North Carolina. And we went to this convention and people went crazy. They went absolutely spare. And I was going, what's the deal? He said, you're Optimus, you're the new Optimus. And I said, okay. And I didn't know what to say. I said, hi. And the new Optimus, and they went, yay! So we basically revived the Transformers franchise because it had been sitting pretty stagnant for a while. And now it's gotten back to what it was when it first came around. It's a big deal.
Safe to say, you saved the franchise.
We saved the franchise. I hesitate to say that, but we did. Beast Wars saved the franchise, yeah, because without Beast Wars, then, you know, Prime and the movies, all those things would never have happened if it weren't for the rise in popularity of Beast Wars. And all I can say is I'm glad to be a part of it. And I'm not any longer being a part of it, but you never know. They're saying they might revive the Beast Wars as one of the movies, but Hasbro did a survey and they found out that that was the most popular.
We'll petition for you.
We'll got petition. Your badge. Excellent. That's all we need. But we're waiting to hear from them. And so that's how I got into the Transformers. Quite by accident. But I had a great time doing it, and I still have a great time. I'm still doing cartoons to this day. Not as prolific as I was then, but I'm near retirement, so I just, you know, you got to take a rest. And you get old. And funnily enough, I went in and read for a new cartoon series the other day, and I read for one character and said, oh, that's great, that's perfect. And then I said, well, I could read for this character. This is kind of a nifty character. And I read, and all the suits were in the studio, and they went, nah, you're too old. I went, what? You're just too old. Your voice sounds too old. I went, but. He said, nope, sorry. So there's ageism even in voiceover. I know it's terrible, but that's the way it goes. But yeah, I'm still doing it, still love it. So there you go. Next, somebody. Yes.
I don't know if this answer. Sorry, we came in a little bit late. When you're doing your when you were doing your voice acting stuff for Beast Wars, what was your favorite like part about doing that itself? Like, just was it doing like was it going into the studio to actually work with like alone or with other people, or was it seeing yourself for the first time voicing that character? Like, what was your favorite part of that whole experience?
Oh, the best part of recording cartoons is recording cartoons.
That's
because what happens when we record up in Canada, because we record up in Canada, and when we do the recording, we do what we call ensemble recording. So everybody's in the room. All the characters are in the room, and we go line, you know, but we're talking to each other. And we set the good guys and the bad guys on either side of the studio. And what that does is gives the interchanges a more organic interchange between the two characters or between characters and brings them to life. But it also makes for some great comedy and some great fun. We used to make paper airplanes out of the script as we finished reading the scenes and fire them around the room. Or have paper ball battles, snowball battles across the studio, and it was quite fun because everybody would be going, all right, man, no, this is insane, no, stop it, line one. And it would it'd be like a switch, you'd just go, tick. And as soon as you hear line one, take one, it was dead silent, the show would start. As soon as they said, and cut, back to Maniac. And it was pretty fun. And the most exciting thing was is that a lot of us had been working as cartoon characters and actors for many years. I've been working with Scott McNeil and Ian Corlett and played with people like that since 1987. And we still work together, and that's, you know, 30 years on. And it's just a riot to work with them because we're all good friends as well as workmates. You know, at first, when I first went to do cartoons, nobody knew each other. We were kind of, you know, a bit tentative, and I don't know if it's just going to sound stupid. Are they going to, you know? But you know, after a while, you just let her rip and. We'd finish the show in 2 hours, and that was one of the things that I quite liked is that we used to do a Christian show called 1-2-3 Penguins. It's from CBN, and they used to record it in Nashville, and it would take 2 days to record one episode. And so then, well, this is taking too long, so they brought it up to Canada, and we'd record an episode in 2 hours. cue the phone. And that blew their mind. That we could finish, oh, that's my, you know, creditors, they never let you go. You know, it doesn't matter where you are, the bills still have to be paid. But they were blown away that we could record an entire show in 2 hours and have it broadcast ready within 2 hours. But that was the difference. That's the difference when you have a lot of many-year veterans working cartoons and novices. Novices have a really hard time to get stuff off the page and make it work. And so that is the best part of doing cartoons. And coming to the conventions, that's always fun.
I have a...
Yeah.
I was going to say, going back, we kind of talked about it last night, about being in the movieverse, so they haven't offered anything yet. You talked about maybe they doing a Beast Wars. Let's say if that doesn't happen, but you're offered a position to voice one of the Transformers in the current, you know, Bayverse or movieverse, is there a particular character that you'd want to do?
Well, I'd love doing Megatron, because Megatron is kind of fun. And I'd love doing Optimus, because Optimus is fun. And I was having a secret desire to do RC, but her voice, I mean, that's who's going to do it. But no, I love Megatron, I love Optimus. Rodimus looks like it'd be kind of fun, but you never know. You go with what they want. I mean, in my mind, I could do them all. In my head, I can do all the voices, but the people who are listening and who are hiring, they go, no, you can't do all the voices. Sorry, this isn't your show. But that's who I would do. I would think. Yes. Yes, sir.
You'd mentioned, you know, the whole like recording process, you know, with having everyone in there. So does Scott McNeil just like stand in the middle, since he did like Good and Bad Guys, or just have him run back and forth?
No, Scotty stands over on the side. They keep him in a little sound booth just by himself.
Build up all that
disruptive force in the studio. Yeah. You have to really keep a handle on him, because, you know, I hate to say it, but he's just incorrigible. And,
We'll edit that.
We like to lock him away. But
we'll edit that.
You know, but it's not going to happen. No, Scotty, he stays in his own spot. Like we have, the way the studio goes, we have three here, and three or four here. And it would be Al Willows, Venus, Scott, and Tarantulas, Starscream.
What's
his name? Big tall guy. Doug.
Doug Parker.
Doug Parker, and then me, Ian, and Richard Newman is running up to me on this side. And that's the way it would be all the time. We always had our assigned spots. And Scotty would be always right here, because then Sue Blue or whoever was directing the episode would look at him and go, you know, keep tabs on it, just got direct eyesight.
And I had a follow-up to that. You know, you mentioned like how you all had a really good chemistry together, because you'd all worked with each other. Were there any kind of ad-libbed parts in Beast Wars like that you guys had, or was it all just straight 100% script? Did they give you any freedom?
Sometimes there were ad-libs, but we very rarely use them, because they were very sticky about it with the scripts at Hasbro.
Right.
But one show that we did have that freedom was a show called Reboot.
Yeah.
Where Hack and Slash, almost all their dialogue was improv.
No kidding.
And they'd have a scripted dialogue, and then we'd do improv dialogue, and we'd do like two takes. And a lot of the improv dialogue was put into the final show, because it was so funny. And Scotty and I, we used to play Hack and Slash and go back and forth. It was quite fun, but very rarely would you get improv in Transformers, simply because of time constraints and story points that you had to adhere to. With Reboot, we had a little bit more leeway, And another show that we did that, where we had a lot of improv that was fun, was Sonic the Hedgehog. We had a lot of improv interplay between Scratch and Grounder, and it was sometimes pretty funny. The funniest, I don't know if you've ever heard we have the famous Coca-Cola incident. We were doing the show, a show called Captain Zed and the Dream Patrol. And we were chasing nightmares. The nightmares were Blitz and Snort or something like that. And they used to do annoying things. This is a song that'll get on your nerves, get on your nerves, get on your nerves. This is a song that'll get on your nerves. Over and over again. And they play it to a belch organ. So you go, and they wanted a big belch for a sample. So I said, okay. So he said, gave me a can of Coke, so I'd have this big, huge belch. And I went like this. He said, are you ready? And he goes, yeah. Ready? Yes. And belch, take one. I went, like this. And this huge ball of foam wrapped in an amniotic sack came out of my mouth, and it hit my script. And I was so shocked, I went like that. And it didn't leave anything on the script. And Phil Hayes and Ian were standing over here. They were killing themselves laughing. The director was dying. The script supervisor was lying on the floor, holding herself, killing. And I said, what? And then I got the belch, and that was fine, and got that. And I said, that's the most disgusting thing I have ever seen in my life. And I had no idea, but it just was like this big ball of foam just came right out of me. And it's on the web somewhere, and somebody recorded it. It's pretty hilarious. But things like that happen, and we had a lot of improvisation between characters, and truly one of the more enjoyable recording experiences I ever had was that one. Next.
I had one about He-Man. As far as the Blue Jeans He-Man and then Man-at-Arms 2000X, yeah. Which one of those did you enjoy working on, you know, the most, as far as, you know?
Well, the first He-Man was fun, and then I got to play several different characters on it. And it was when I was relatively new to cartoons. I think it was only my second one, or third one, I'm not sure. But again, I was, I said, do this. So, okay, you got the part. And I went, oh, cool. And I got the part, and then I got my check, and I went, boy, I love this job. I love this job. But I like doing Man-at-Arms. Man-at-Arms, to me, seemed to have a lot more character, a lot more depth than He-Man. He-Man was kind of, here I am with my battle cat Cringer and Teela. And then we go, Skeletor, we've been fighting for centuries. This is totally wrong. We cannot fight anymore. I will defeat you. And he goes,
now so what? I don't care, He-Man.
And I thought, that's cool. But Man-at-Arms was like me. He's got it down and out. Come on, He-Man, Jesus Christ. Program, and I like that. And that's one of the joys of doing cartoons, is you can play so many different characters and be so many different people. That it's a real joy if you can get one that you can really sink your teeth into.
I kind of had a follow-up to that one is, like you said that you go to the BotCon, back then, and people were like, oh, you're Optimus Primal. You had that fan reaction. I know that He-Man, they have like PowerCon. I don't know if you've ever been to one of those, but do you kind of get the same fan reaction from like Masters of the Universe fans?
I get the same reaction from Universe friends. I've, to tell you the truth, I've never been to a PowerCon for some unknown reason. Sherry does never wants me to go to these things. I don't know why, but there you go. So I don't go to PowerCons, but I do get the reactions from fans. The funniest reaction I ever got was I was riding a bus. I was shooting a movie in Victoria, Vancouver Island. And I was riding a bus to the downtown. So I just wanted to hang out for the day because I had a day off. And we were close to downtown, our hotel. And I asked, so do you stop by the Empress Hotel? And some guy in the back of the bus goes, hey! Hey, that voice! I know that voice! I know that voice! Hey, who is that? And the guy came running up in the back of the bus and goes, oh my God, it's you! You're Optimus! You're that guy! And I said, yes! I knew it was you! I can hear you from back of the bus! And I said, okay, great. And he was a sailor. He was stationed at Esquimalt, at the naval base in Esquimalt. And he was going on, and I thought, oh, I'm just going to have a nice day, go down the, you know. And then all of a sudden, on the bus, the whole bus goes, you're that guy. You're the guy. Hey, it's that guy. You're that. So now you just want a nice, quiet bus ride downtown. So, no, everybody wants to know everything about you and what you're doing. And it's the one thing that I find that's quite wonderful about doing these things is that, doing cartoons, I mean, is that cartoons have a lot of archetypes, and they're archetypal heroes and villains, and they're very clearly delineated. And these days, we have so many people that we have looked up to as heroes that really aren't, and a lot of role models that we look up to that really aren't great role models. And it seems like a lot of the role models and a lot of the qualities that we admire in these archetypal characters that we watch on TV are the ones that we want to see in our ourselves and our real life heroes, and sadly that's not happening these days. And I've often wondered about the brony phenomenon. You know, why do these guys who are in their 20s and 30s just go crazy for My Little Pony and watching the shows and going to the conventions? Because the themes and the stories of My Little Pony are a world that we'd love to have, or these guys would like to have, but don't have at the moment. And that, to me, was quite telling. So it's a responsibility that we have to maintain that persona, that character, and be who that person is, and be good, basically. And that's what we needed more of in this world, a lot more good. Anyway, anything else that you have any questions? We got one in the back. You know everything.
This is from someone else.
I was just curious if you've ever had a negative experience with a fan over a character, like something that they were upset about.
Oh yeah, I've had a few of those with Transformers. It's the truck monkey debate.
What is
truck monkey?
Yes,
monkey truck. You know, they have that debate, and I've had some guys go, "Oh man, Armada just sucked," and you get that on the internet. And I said, "Man, everybody has their own choices. You either like it or you don't. If you don't like it, hey, no skin off my teeth. I've been paid." You know. I mean, it's not to say that I don't care about quality and performance. I care about everything I do and put 100% of my energy and my efforts into everything I do, which is why I've had a career that's lasted about 38 years. So you cannot please everybody all the time. If you did, then you're doing something wrong. You've got to instill some kind of powerful feelings or strong feelings, either for or against. And the ones who are against, hey, that's their prerogative. The ones who are for, that's great too. But I don't care if you don't like it, it's you don't have to watch it. If you don't like it, you don't have to watch it. And that's just the way it is. You can't be everything to everyone all the time. So I've resigned myself to that. I mean, some people say, you know, for different reasons, this person is a terrible actor, that person's a terrible actor, we hated this show, we hated that, but we love this show, and we love that show, and other people love them. It's personal taste. Personally, I can't stand Mexican food, but there you go. It's just one of those things. It doesn't say that it's bad, because, you know, my wife and my kids, they love it. They love all that enchiladas and tostadas and all that stuff. Personally, I just can't stand it. But it's not because I don't like the culture. I just don't like the food. Pretty simple, you know. But I love Chinese food. And other people go, oh, it looks like insects. But, you know, it's personal choice. Yeah, now, you have a question, miss?
Barry Shaw has a question. Question for Garry from the Kilted One across the pond. Do you tackle voice acting to being on screen differently?
Do you tackle
voice acting to being on screen differently? I guess approaching them?
Do I tackle voice on screen and voiceover differently? Sort of. When you're voicing for cartoons, you have to provide everything. You have to provide the geography, the emotional, and the intellectual intent has to be perfectly clear. So when you're doing cartoons and you're doing the voices, you have to fill in all those gaps because the artist draws around your voice. So what happens is you voice it, but then you add all the things like the physicality of the character. Example is two guys sitting in a cell. They hear hammering outside. There's a window just out of reach. And one says to the other, God, I wonder what's going on out there. Now, visually, you go, now, in the script, it says the guy sitting there gets up, walks over to the wall, leaps up, and looks out the window to see what's going on. So it goes like this. Gee, I wonder what's going on over there. It's a different thing. You don't do all that on film. And on film, in animation, you're looking at 32 frames, 28 frames, or whatever per second. So they don't fill in every gap, every tick, every eye bat, every whatnot, because it's just too much information. So you're only given the mouth flaps and, you know, eyes opening and closing. So the more that you give it, the more you make it more hyper-real, let's say, just above real. When they draw it, it flattens it out. The normal performance. It looks normal when it's fully drawn, but it sounds like it's too much when you first record it. But as soon as they put the drawing in, it comes down normal. Now the camera, when you're doing in front of the camera never lies. The camera is a very intimate part of this scene. So it catches every eye movement, every cheek tick, every jaw, every flinch, every this. All your body language, it catches. And it catches every single line. So you have to be as honest, as real as possible on camera. So you're playing it to a real person rather than giving it a bit more. That's about fundamentally the only real difference is the delivery. But the intent, the emotional intent, the physical intent has to be real, and that's what film is all about. One of my biggest pet peeves in making movies these days is a lot of young actors mumbling, and it drives me crazy when I see people like Kristen Stewart, who's from the, you know, the werewolf.
Twilight.
Huh?
Twilight.
The Twilight guy. I'm going, shut up. Come on. I want to hear what you have to say. When I see the, shut up, speak up. I paid to hear these words. And a lot of people these days, they mumble. We've had great debates about it. And it used to be, you know, when I first started in film, you know, when in doubt, mumble. Because mumbling is sort of kind of like the X-Files school of acting, where it's everything's so close and so small and so intimate, but you can't hear what you can say. But it sounds so cool, you know, because you're not really doing anything. That's cool. You know, me, it's just annoying. I find, you know, I want to hear the story. You want to tell me a story, I want to hear every word. And that's basically the difference. Thanks, Barry. Who is it?
Yeah, Barry Shaw.
Oh, yeah, okay. Another question. Yes?
Has there ever been somebody that you've worked with, either in voice acting or in your film roles, have you ever came across somebody that you were almost starstruck by, like somebody you really admired that you got to work with that was like a really cool moment?
Oh, yeah. No, I got, the first time I was ever starstruck working with somebody I worked with, James Coburn. James Coburn from the old, you know, The Great Escape, and Magnificent Seven, Our Man Flint, all those shows. I first started working with him and I couldn't talk. But I found that it was just incredible that I got to work with him. And he turned out to be such a nice guy. I really admired him a lot. As far as the voice actors go, I first worked with Maurice LaMarche about 20 years ago. I remember when he came in the studio and I went, oh, that's Maurice LaMarche. They're going to be such a tool. And we were doing Salty's Playhouse or something like that, or Salty's Lighthouse or something. And we finished, and he came up to me and he said, man, you are really good in there. And I went, thanks. Felt like a knob. I went, thanks. But we became friends after that. We've been friends ever since. So that was quite nice. And I was not really intimidated, but I got a little bit starstruck by a Tex Avery guy, the guy who voiced Baby Huey. I don't even remember Baby Huey. The big ugly duckling, that big stupid duck.
Nah, nobody wanted to.
Huh? Nobody. I want to play with you guys. Come on, let's go. That guy. And I got to do a revival of Baby Huey several years ago. And the guy who did the original Baby Huey voice was like 85. And he was there. And he was doing the voice. And it was exactly the same as it was when I was a kid watching Baby Huey. And I was just in awe. I thought he was the coolest guy. He was so great. That was a lot of fun. So there's that. Okay, keeping you up. No. Anyway, anyone else? Yeah. Okay, we'll get this one here in the corner.
Okay. I don't know if anyone asked, but I'm dying to know about your experience on the episode Babylon of the X-Files. How was that?
Which one?
Babylon.
X-Files?
Mm-hmm.
That was... Oh, I improvised that. with another person. I played a pro-left... gun control advocate, and this black woman played the pro-right, Second Amendment all the way. We had a big debate, and the thing was, like, I worked with X-Files guys many years ago when they very first started. I turned down X-Files three times to do shows because I had my own series. I had another series that I was doing, and I kept turning them down because I could never make the dates work. But Chris Carter, who produced it, was a great guy. We had a great fun, great pal. And he was, when he revived X-Files, he said, "Hey, you're gonna come and work with us?" And I said, "Well, I don't know." And he says, "Look, I got a show coming up. Come and do the show. Just for the day. It'll be fun. We'll have a good time." And I said, "Okay." And I went and improvised this whole thing on television while they were investigating something else. And I remember the end of it. We got a standing ovation at the end. And I said, "That's great. We finished before wrap time. So thank you, guys." And I just love those guys. Jillian and all of the actors who were on that, Nicholas Lee and that, they're all pals. They've been pals for years now. And we've worked together many times in various other projects. And it was a point of pride for me as the only A-list actor in Vancouver who had never worked on X-Files, so, which I thought was quite fun. "Nope, never worked on it. What are you talking about? Everybody's worked on it." "No, not me. No, I couldn't be bothered." But I got tons of stories about shows. I mean, about shows that I've worked on, playing practical jokes, and remember saving the life of a director who was a primary director on Stargate. And we were sitting in a bar, and he'd had a couple of drinks. And he would say, "Nobody gives a damn about the Roman Catholics. Mary, she's that bitch, da-da-da-da-da-da." And I'm going, "What are you talking about? You can't say that. I don't care. And this guy who looked like a serial killer, with those eyes that look right through you, he came up and he dropped a picture of Mary, the Virgin Mary, on the table in front of him and said, "Take that back." And he totally oblivious. "I'm not taking back nothing." And this guy went white. And I thought, "Oh my God, you're gonna die. So I stood up and I said, "Hey buddy, come here, listen. Let's go over here. I'm gonna kill him. No, he's just had a few drinks. No, he can't talk about the Mary. He can't talk about the Virgin like that." And I said, "Yes, he can. No, I'll go." Saved his life. The same guy, he offered me a part in X-Files, and I said, "I'm sorry. I can't do it because I'm booked." And he goes, "You are a faggot." And I said, "What?" He said, "You're a faggot and an ass. How could you? I asked you to do my show. You said no. Well." And I said, "Oh, come here. I'll buy you a beer." I'll never forget that. Now we just had some fun. I remember sneaking onto his set. I snuck onto his set once as a dressed in my Chekhov uniform and sat on the Stargate Universe or Stargate Atlantis set that he was directing as one of the extras, but in my uniform. And he's sitting there and he goes, "All right, rolling, roll cameras, okay, who's that? What's this? What are you doing on my set? Get on my set, yeah!" So funny, I go up and say hi. But stuff like that happens all the time. But, anything else?
I don't know. Yeah. We were talking about the other day that you rarely play a villain role. But yeah. You were on recently this season of Arrow. Yeah. What was it like working with that cast? Because I know that there was a lot of action scenes for you as well, I believe, in your first episode. Yeah. What was it like playing that villain after you played, you know, basically the good guy character for majority of your career?
I loved it. I love being a villain. Villains have the best lines. Villains get to be deliciously evil. And it's what I loved about it is you get to revel in it. You know, because here's the thing, and I've got this theory. Nobody thinks they're the bad guy. No, bad guys, they don't go, "Yes, I'm the bad guy, and you're the good guy." but I'm bad and you're good. They don't, no, they go, I'm the good guy, I'm just misunderstood. And that's the whole thing behind what makes villains effective, what makes a great villain effective is they never think they're the bad guy. They always think they're the good guy. You're the bad guy for screwing up my plans of world domination, you know. And so that's how I play villains like that. And everybody comes, you know, been commenting on Facebook and that's it. Ah, Joe Walker's such a badass. I said, no, he's just a good guy who's misunderstood. And I just loved it. And when they gave me the role, I thought it was just a one-off, and it turned into a four-episode deal. And apparently I'm going back next season, so.
Oh, awesome.
Which is kind of fun. And very excited about that. And so I love playing villains. And working with Steve Amell and the guy who played Diggle and those characters, wonderful. Great people, great fun to hang out with. Steve's a little quiet, keeps to himself. He's always on iPad. He's an iPad addict. You know those guys. I have a wife like that who's a phone addict. She wakes up and she's lying in bed and goes like this. She'll do that for like 10 minutes. We haven't even got out of bed. She just woke up, she literally opened her eyes. Going through, doing the Facebook, doing the Twitter, doing the emails, you know, the phone. Oh, Skype, somebody on Skype. And then just go through the whole gamut. And then be like, and we'll be having it surgically implanted in her hand, if they could, all day long. I don't know how you do it. I think that would drive me crazy. But he loved his iPad, so he was always on the iPad all the time. But that's a great set. The thing I liked about the working on Arrow is that I've worked with all those their crew, their senior crew, so I've been working with those crews for 20 years. So. And it's a well-oiled machine like Stargate was. And that always makes it nice because, you know, when you know you go in at 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock in the morning, you know you're getting out at 6. You're not getting out at 10. Always makes it go. We're sorry. Got a wobbly tail. I'll fix that in a second. Another question. Yes.
You mentioned you love doing bad guys. And kind of speaking of the big bad guy, have you ever tried doing a David K. Megatron? And if you have, do you think you could? Could we hear something?
Yes. Of course I could. No problem at all. No, I played lots of villains in cartoons. Yeah. Played Lord Viper and King Arthur, Knights of Justice. Played King Hippo, Captain N. Played Whiplash and He-Man. I wanted to be Skeletor, but they wouldn't let me. So I couldn't be Skeletor. But I've done Destro, G.I. Joe, Scratch Guy. Yeah, I've done my fair share of villains in cartoons. Femur was a really fun one in a thing called War Planets. What is it called here now?
It was War Planets. I think Shadow Raiders was one of
them. Shadow Raiders. Hi, Joe. I love that character. He was very funny. And he had a gay sidekick. Played by Scott McNeil. Oh. What a surprise! No.
We'll edit that.
Okay. Any other questions? Mommy! There's the boys. Are you guys having fun? Are you? You're giving your mother a heart attack?
Yeah.
Now, I'm awake, I'm alive, I'm... Oh yeah? Oh yeah, so are you! Drowning in waves. Yeah, that looks like you're in the ocean, you know. One of the chairs could just move a little bit, you'd have waves. You'd be surfing. But I think I've got 3 minutes left, so Make it good. Now, you wanted to ask a question, I know, but you're just shy. Aren't you? Yes. Now, you wanted to ask some questions, but you're... I know that you want to ask some questions. Oh, pick me. Okay.
Okay, you know, I'm going to go X-Files route again. What do you think of William B. Davis?
What about him?
Like, you enjoy...
Bill Davis?
William B. Davis.
Are you talking about Smoking Man?
Yes.
Yeah. Known him for years, decades, 30 years.
Oh, wow.
Long, long time. Bill and I are friends. We don't see eye to eye politically.
Uh-huh.
He's a bit of a knob, but that way, I mean, his whole thing, like he's a big, like in local politics, we're talking about local politics.
Oh, okay.
He's a big supporter of our mayor, and I am not. The mayor's an idiot, the bag of hammers. He's so dumb, he literally cannot walk and chew gum at the same time. He's just not a very bright boy, but. No, Bill does all right. He's got an acting school in Vancouver, and he's retired now. He lives in the south of France most of the time. But I like Bill. I think Bill's great. We've worked together on a few shows together, and socially we see each other all the time. So.
Wow.
Yeah. He's a good egg. I like him. But you wanted to know about voiceover, huh?
Just a little bit.
Yeah. Oh, come on. Just a little bit?
A lot.
Do you practice at home?
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit? I'm not going to commit myself to anything here, but I can tell someone who has a secret passion. What? Pachiro, 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 pachiro. Pew, pew, pew. Yeah, you're dead now. All right, see ya. Oh, wait, here comes a grenade. Now they're blown to bits. But, these days it's so easy to have a good home studio. I mean, I use GarageBand off of Mac, and all you need is a good preamp and a good mic. And you're done. And the preamps are not that expensive. Microphones can go up, you know, but you can get a really good microphone for about $100. And all the tools you basically need are right there on GarageBand. It's very user friendly, and it's user friendly in that you can mail media out to a lot of different spots. And I use it at home as a home studio all the time to send out all my auditions on PDFs. That's a lot easier than going to a studio or going down to the agency and recording and just record it at home and just bang it off. And there's all these places like Voices 123 and Voice Bank and Voice Box and that, where you can fire off these things and they'll get you work. You just have to keep practicing at it, and they'll send you a copy, you record it at home, make yourself a demo. Send it out there, and there's an old trick I play. You know, people think, oh, I couldn't do voices. I don't have any voices. Well, you all got voices. You got at least 6 voices in your head. And the way it works is this: your body is like the body of. I'll be there in 1 minute. Your body is like the body of a guitar or violin. It's a resonator. We have this giant resonator that's called our body, and we have them here in our sinuses, in our jaws, in our mouths, in our chest, our skulls, even in the backs of our knees and in the back. We have this resonator, and if you put your hand here, you can feel your voice vibrating all over your body. You can feel it. So what you do is you find out how to isolate those resonators to come out with different sounds, and it sounds like this. If I put the voice in the top of my head, I don't have to change my voice at all. If I put my voice in the top of my head, take it into my eyes, from my eyes into my nose, You take it from your nose into the front of your mouth. You get this tight kind of sound into the middle of your mouth, which gives you a totally different sound to the back of your throat and down into your chest, which gives you that big, full, rich sound. And you really don't change your tone all that much. Now you can add a little bit of gravel to that. Take that gravel into your throat, into the middle of your mouth, the front of your teeth, into your nose, and into your eyes, and the top of your head. So you have all these different voices. Now all you have to do to change them is you can change the shape of your jaw. As soon as you put your jaw out, all of a sudden that character comes out. Or you can change your rhythm patterns. Or you can change the pronunciation of certain words. Or you can adopt a pose and become a hero. Or another pose and become a thinker. You know, there's all these things that you can do. And it's all about physicality, placing the voices in a different place, finding attitudes. You know, the scaredy cat, the shy, the bravado character, the sly character. There's so many different ones that you can do. And all that you can, and you can do them all with your own voice. I mean, when you listen to Mel Blanc, and listen to Mel Blanc, really listen, it's all the same voice. His voice is exactly the same, but with an impediment, like, hey, that little silly little bird, I'm so ashamed. To Tweety, I thought I tore a pretty cat. To who was that other one? Foghorn Leghorn, who, I say, boy, you're built close to the ground. A lot of things go over your head, you know? But it's the same voice. He just puts it in a different place. You know, when he does Sylvester, Tweety, or Hey, Bandy Coward, with Yosemite Sam, or Baby Love You, he adds a little French to it, becomes a Frenchman, right? It's just, it's the same voice. It's just adding things. It's like you're, instead of building a character as a all-around character, you're building a character around your voice. And that's what you're doing. And you can have a lot of fun with it. And if you're really good, you can make a pile of cash with it, too. So there you go. Anyway, that friend, unfortunately, is all the time I have for questions, because they only give me so much.